Bettina Geppa, ladies and gentlemen, has published her latest novel, The Book of Memory, which is published now in Dutch this week. Well, maybe you can tell us something about it.
Well, it took 6 years to write. I had one of the longest episodes of writer's block in history. So it was 6 years between books. I'm very glad to have finished it. It's a book that I feel very strongly about. It's very hard to summarize, but I guess the best way of summarizing is to say that it is the story of a young woman who is writing for her life. She is the only prisoner in Zimbabwe on death row, and she's writing the story of how she came to be on death row. Because in Zimbabwe, we still have the death penalty. But since the most recent changes to the constitution, women, you can't execute women, but you know, if you're a man, you can be executed. And so it's partly a book that is rooted in my very, very strong belief that the death penalty is just wrong. But also, I just wanted to tell a story. And I also wanted to tell the story of a very isolated individual, because there's no lonelier place than being the only woman in the whole country on death row. But it's also it's a grim subject, but it's not as grim as I'm making it sound. There's like with everything with Zimbabwe, there's a lot of humor there as well. So there are a few funny moments even in prison.
Yeah. Is it based on a true story or true fact?
It was inspired by a story I read that there was actually only one woman on death row. So I just thought to myself, my goodness, that must be an incredibly lonely place to be. And what could possibly have gotten, thank you so much, what could possibly have gotten this woman to this place? So I just imagined a character who was on death row. Yeah.
And that book is published in English?
Yes, it was published in the UK in September. And then the Dutch are always the first out of the block. So the Dutch edition is the first international edition to come out this month, this week. And then in the US, it's going to be published in February, and then across Scandinavia in summer, in France and other places as well.
And are your books also read in Zimbabwe?
Yes. That's one of the biggest things you want as a writer. You want to be read by your own people. So I'm very privileged in that my first book, even though not published in Zimbabwe, has been distributed fairly widely in Zimbabwe, and the second one as well. But unfortunately, with the second one, just a week before my book landed in Zimbabwe, the government hiked the tax for books and the tariffs for books. So instead of having a 0% duty, which is what the international agreement is for books and other educational materials, they've hiked it to 40%, making it a luxury product. So in Zimbabwe, my book is like an Italian handbag or champagne, which is very disconcerting. And what it actually means is that it's more expensive in Zimbabwe than anywhere else in the world. So it's $25. And so it's deeply embarrassing, you know, to me when people ask me, where can we find your book? And I tell them where they can find it, but they have to fork out $25, which is just wrong. So we're hoping that the paperback, which comes out in May, will be even cheaper. And my publisher has promised a special deal for my Zimbabwean distributors.
And is it possible to create a political discussion about
themes? Oh, believe me, we've been hounding the Minister of Education on Twitter, Facebook, and he was so embarrassed by this, because I wrote a very strong opinion about how basically he is pricing Zimbabweans out of an education, because we're supposed to have the highest literacy rate in Africa. So we have this high literacy rate, but there are no books. And the books that are available are too expensive for people to buy. And this tax was going to apply even to textbooks. So even children's books, you know. So in the end, they revised it so that textbooks still come in at the zero duty level, but novels come in at the 40% duty. And I've got a friend who imported copies of Hamlet, which is a Shakespeare text, for A-level. And she was asked to pay something like 5,000 for, I don't know how many, 500 copies or so. And she said to them, but this is a textbook. It's on the school syllabus. And they said to her, ah, no, madam, Hamlet is a novel. I don't know what Shakespeare would say about that. And then when I engaged with the authorities, the ZIMRA, the Zimbabwe Revenue Authority, I had this very charming gentleman say to me, ah, you know, Bettina, you're right. Maybe we can have this deal where you, as a writer, if you're bringing your own books, you get the zero duty. And then I said, well, but what about Shakespeare? I mean, he's not going to rock up at Harare Airport and say, I would like to bring in these books at zero duty. So, I mean, it's a very poorly thought out policy, but we're hoping that with enough pressure and enough publicity, we're even involving UNESCO in Paris, you know, because under the UNESCO deal, they're supposed to bring in books at zero duty. So we're doing a lot. Yeah.
And you've chosen the text of your life, and the text of your life is in the a fragment from the King James Bible.
Yeah. Can I tell you how I came to choose that text of my life?
Yes.
Shame, I gave the wonderful curators of this festival such a hard time because I was traveling between places and they kept asking me to choose things and I was panicking. And then I got a message from Maria to say, can you please send something to me before Christmas? And it was around Christmas, and Handel was playing in the background, you know, for unto us a child is born, for unto us a son is born. I thought, oh, that's a lovely text. So that's what I chose. But I also just love the Bible. I always identify myself as an atheist who loves religion. I love the Bible. It's a book I grew up with. But I grew up with a very plain version of the Bible, with the Good News Bible. I was at a Catholic school and we were reading the Good News Bible. And then, thanks to the wonderful writer P.D. James, I discovered the Anglican version of the Bible. I discovered the Book of Common Prayer. I discovered the King James Bible. And I just fell completely in love with the Bible all over again because it's so beautifully written. It's a book that I turn to again and again at different periods in my life. And also because I'm writing about Zimbabwe, which is a very strong Christian country, it's important to me that I reflect the beliefs of Zimbabweans in my writing.
Yeah. And is it also inspiring because of the style, the technique?
Yeah, I mean, look, if you look at this text, yeah, it's insane. I mean, there's this... there's so much horror as well in the Bible, and that's not talked about enough sometimes. I mean, there's some seriously violent
language. It's a real catalogue of vices
and
crimes.
Lots of genocide. And so there's this wonderfully violent language, and then there's in the next verse you've got something really beautiful. You know, so do you mind if I just read maybe the first two verses? So this is from Isaiah 9, verses 5 to 7. For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise and garments rolled in blood, but this shall be with burning and fuel of fire. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end. I mean, that's really beautiful.
Yes.
But the preceding verse is like, what is this about the confused noise and the burning and the fire? That's pretty threatening language, you know? And then comes this really beautiful promise that, you know, there's going to be this son who's given to us, to the community of mankind, and his government shall be a just one. And it's really lovely. I just love it. Yeah.
And is it something you read for, to be inspired for your own writing?
Yeah, what I love about the King James version, and interestingly enough, the last time at the Winter Nocturne Festival, I talked about the Book of Job, and I read a chapter from the Book of Job, and I think what I love about this particular version of the Bible is the rhythm of the words and the beauty of the language. And I like writing that has rhythm. I like musicality in a text. So I hear the words and I hear the music behind it. So that's what I love the most about this. Because it's the same Bible as the Good News or, you know, any of the other versions, but there's just something really wonderful about how this particular one came to be. I always say it's the best thing about Henry's desire to marry Anne Boleyn. That, you know, the one of the end results of that whole reformation of the church in England was, you know, this beautiful project, which is the King James Bible.
That's the result.
Yeah,
a good result.
Although the other wives of Henry probably wouldn't think that was a very positive thing. I mean, if you lose your head, it's very hard to see the funny side of anything. Yeah.
Afterwards, yeah. That's hard. Do you travel with a Bible?
Yes, I do. I've got a. I don't have it with me now. It's very freaky if you're on a plane to whip out your Bible. You know, you get people very nervous. Yeah. So I don't actually travel with it on the plane, but I'm actually writing a new book now. It's about to be finished, and one of the things I'm doing is a short story collection about justice. It's about crime in Zimbabwe. And one of the things I've done for each short story, I've started it out with a quotation about justice from different bits of the Bible. So I've got a very light Bible that I travel with. And it's always very odd when I talk to my Zimbabwean friends because, as I said before, Zimbabwe is a very Christian country and it's become a very Pentecostal country. So a very particular type of Christianity. And I've declared my atheism. I've been an atheist since I was 17. And they just can't find it. You know, they just don't understand how somebody who's not a believer can still value the Bible. And so when I say to them that the Bible is a great book of literature, it's a work of art, you know, it's almost like I'm saying something sacrilegious, you know, something really blasphemous. But that's really how I feel about it.
And you told me 6 years ago when you were living then in Geneva, and afterwards you're going back to Zimbabwe. And 3 years ago you moved back from Zimbabwe to Geneva again. Is it for you when you compare it, is it different to write, you're writing about Zimbabwe?
Oh, that's such a good question.
Being
there
or living elsewhere, writing about your
That's
country.
A really good question. Actually, I had that question earlier today in an interview that I did for one of the papers. And I would say that the quality of how I write about Zimbabwe when I'm in Zimbabwe is very different. My first book, I wrote it outside Zimbabwe. I mean, I'm very control freaky about research. I research everything. I want to know what the new slang is. So as soon as the $1 million bill was introduced, I wanted to know what the nickname was. Then came the $1 billion bill. It was called a bidza. The $1 million one was called a meter. And that's how quickly language moves. So I wanted to be on top of it. So I had to do a very forensic sort of research exercise to make sure that I was really writing how Zimbabweans talked. But when I was actually in Zimbabwe, it was much, much easier because every time I went out onto the street, and I'm an inveterate eavesdropper, I love listening into conversations. So I just go out onto the street and I use public transport a lot, and people talk. And so the rhythm, that rhythm on the streets, found its way into my book in a very natural way. So I think in many ways, it's terrible to ask a writer to analyze themselves, but if I'm to be very, very honest, I would say that An Elegy for Easterly is a better book because I wrote it without fear. There were no expectations. I wrote it for myself. The Book of Memory is a very anxious book because I wrote it to an audience. I had publishers waiting for it. So it's a very anxious, very sort of maybe even self-regarding book. But it's a more natural book because I wrote it in the environment in which it happened. So yes, I would say that moving back to Zimbabwe did have that. And it also gave me the confidence that I could actually write about Zimbabweans because they were around me all the time. And you know, when you're that far away and you're writing from a distance, you worry about, oh, that horrible word, authenticity. You know, are you authentically representing the people you're writing about and so on? Yeah.
So.
Sorry, that was a really long answer. It's the wine.
It's a very good answer. Thank you very much. We will We will read the Book of Memory, of course, and we will reread the Bible and consider it now as a work of art. Thank you very much for your
contribution.
Thank you
so much. Thank you. It's lovely. Thank you.